Welcome to One Life Church and Merry Christmas. My name is Justin and I'm one of the pastors here. We're a group of people committed to bringing the kingdom of Jesus to earth, one life at a time through intentional relationships. We aim to create environments that nurture family, authenticity, and a culture of investment. We believe that one life can make a difference and we want to help you do just that. Now, whether you're exploring faith, looking for a church home, or even seeking a deeper connection with Jesus, you are welcome here. Now, before we jump into the sermon, I want to ask you to do two things for me. Number one, hit that subscribe button so that you can follow along with what God is doing in and through One Life Church. And number two, in the description below, you're going to find a link for onelifechurch.tv. This is where you can learn more about our church and how you can get involved. If you live in the Concord, North Carolina area, I want to invite you to join us in person on a Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m. You can plan your visit at onelifechurch.tv. During our sermons this Christmas season, we're going to be exploring the longing that each of us have deep inside for a place called home. I pray that today's sermon encourages you to trust Jesus in every situation that you're facing right now. Welcome home.
I'll be home for Christmas, if only in my dreams.
So today, we are starting a new series of teachings called I'll Be Home for Christmas. And this is the beginning of our Advent teaching series. And some of you grew up in a tradition where you celebrated Advent, you observed Advent. If you grew up in a tradition where you observed Advent and you know a little bit about Advent, raise your hand for me. A few of you. All right. And if you're like me, I grew up in a tradition where we never talked about the church calendar. And I didn't have any idea what Advent was until sometime late in college. And that was the first time that I was introduced to the idea of Advent and the church calendar. But over the last 8 years since I came to One Life, every Christmas we talk about Advent. And so I want to take just a few minutes to, for those of us in the room that may not know exactly what Advent is, I want us to be on the same page. So what is Advent? Well, Advent is the four Sundays that lead us up to Christmas when we celebrate the birth of Jesus. And so for those four Sundays, for those 4 weeks leading up to Christmas, we are anticipating the coming of Jesus. We are expecting that Jesus is going to come. The Messiah is going to come. Now, we do this in a couple different ways, okay? First is we are reminded during Advent that between the Old Testament, the end of the Old Testament, and the beginning of the New Testament, the people of God waited for the Messiah to come for 400 years. And in their waiting, they heard nothing. They had 400 years of silence. We have a hard time not hearing from God for 4 minutes. We say a prayer and we want him to instantly answer. They waited for 400 years. 400 years. Can you wrap your mind around that? And they anticipated, they longed for the coming of the Messiah that the prophets had promised would come. And so during Advent, we are reminded that the people of God have always been a waiting people, that we have always been a people longing for the coming of the Messiah. Another way that we wait in the time of Advent is that we wait or we long for the Messiah, for Jesus, to come into the places of our lives where we need him most, into the shadowed places, into the really difficult places, into the broken places of our lives. That we long for, we expect that Jesus will be faithful to his promise, that he is going to come into those places in our lives in the here and now, and he is going to do a work of restoration, a work of reconciliation. So we wait, we anticipate that Jesus will do what he says he will do. And then we also, during Advent, we are waiting as the people of God, We have been waiting for 2,000 years for Jesus to fulfill his promise that he will come back and he will restore this thing. That he is going to come back and he is going to take us to be with him for all eternity. And that is going to happen. And so during Advent, as we long for, as we wait, we expect Jesus, we are remembering what he's done in the past, we are seeing what he's doing in the present, and we are longing for what he will do in the future. Now, we wait. And this is what we're going to talk about this morning. We are waiting for our new home to become a reality. Our new home that is out in front of us, that has been promised to us, we are waiting for that to become a reality. Now, all of us as human beings, we all long for a place called home. I'm sure you've had this experience where someone has asked you, where's home? Or where are you from? And if you're like me, my family, we moved around a little bit. And that question is always so weird to me. I mean, do I tell them that I'm from North Carolina, where I've lived for 20 years? Do I tell them that I'm from Southern Indiana, where I lived for 14 years? Or do I tell them that I'm from the mid part of Indiana, where I lived for the first part of my life? Where is home? Where is home? This past summer, my Grandma Wallace, my last grandparent, she passed away. And in September, we went up to celebrate her life. And I knew that it was going to be weird because my family had moved around, it was always that her house was the home base. That was home. And so when I would go back to Indiana and I would go back to my grandma and grandpa's house, I would walk in, I would walk out on their back porch, and I was home. I was home. I felt it. When I walked in their house and they were there, I could feel that this, you know that feeling that you get? Like it's just you can relax and be. Like I was home. Well, now she wasn't there. And I didn't know what to expect. I knew it was going to be a little weird. It was going to be full of lots of emotions. And I remember the night that I walked into her house, and it was my cousins and it was my aunts and uncles. And I walked in and I walked into the living room and I sat down in the place where I've had so many conversations with my grandparents, so many experiences, so many memories, and I had the weirdest feeling. I wasn't home. It didn't feel like home anymore. I don't know if you've ever had that feeling, but all of a sudden, I was stuck in this tension where, like, it was supposed to be home, but it's not home anymore. And we as human beings, we all live in this tension. We as followers of Jesus, more importantly, we all live in this tension. I mean, we know that we live here on earth. We have an address here on earth. God has put us here at a specific time for a specific purpose. We live here on earth, and yet, doesn't feel like home. Doesn't feel like home. We know, we believe that our home is actually somewhere else. Now, in my lifetime, I have seen a certain pendulum swing in the church when it comes to this conversation about home and how we treat this place as earth. So very early on in my life, when I was in high school, Billy Graham was still doing his crusades, where he would go city to city, from stadium to stadium, and he would preach the gospel to thousands of people, and people would respond to this gospel and give their lives to Jesus. And it was an amazing, amazing movement of God during that time. And Billy Graham, he really, the gospel that he preached was centered around this question. It would always lead to this question. It would be something like this. If you died tonight, do you know where you would be? Do you know where you would go? And for Billy Graham, the gospel really centered around this idea of our hope being in heaven, an eternal place that we would spend with God. Well, the pendulum swung over the last 20 years. And what has happened over the last 20 years in the church is that we have moved away from this gospel of that we have an eternal home to asking, well, what about here? Like, what about justice? And what about oppressive systems? And how do we make this place better? How do we love our neighbors in the here and now? Now, I'm not saying one is right and one is wrong. I'm just pointing out and observing a pendulum swing that we have experienced in our lifetime. But this got me thinking. What I also notice in the church today is I notice a lot of hopelessness. I notice, especially when things like get bad or get hard, it's the end of all things. I don't know if you've noticed this, but like there's a certain level of hopelessness that is even settled upon the church in 2024. And it got me wondering. I wonder if it's possible that that hopelessness that I see in so many Christians in the church in 2024 is the result of us not longing for our real eternal home anymore. Somebody's phone is ringing. That's cool. Okay, good. All right. So I wonder, did you get that? I wonder if our hopelessness is somehow attached to us not longing for what is out in front of us. If we are no longer keeping our eyes focused on this is not our home, we have a home that is going to come. Now in John 14, verses 1 through 3, Jesus speaks directly to this deep longing that we all have in our human heart. These verses, they're part of what is called the farewell discourse in the Gospel of John. It's a series of teachings that Jesus gave to his disciples just before he goes to the cross. This is a time of great emotional weight and distress for his disciples. Can you imagine? They've walked with this man for 3 years. He's become their friend. He's become their rabbi, their teacher. They spent every hour of every day with him. And all of a sudden, he starts telling them, I'm going to die. They're going to kill me. I mean, they've seen it a couple other times over the years, but now is the time. And so there's a lot of distress. There's a lot of like, what is next? What's coming? There's a lot of sadness, a lot of grief, a lot of confusion. And in John 14, verses 1 through 3, Jesus is preparing them for what they're about to experience. He's preparing to leave them, and they are troubled. Yet in the midst of their confusion, he offers them a profound reassurance and a profound promise. He says, don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. There's more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come to get you so that you will always be with me where I am. Okay. When I hear John 14, 1 through 3, the first thing I think of is this video. Check this video out. House. It's a big, big house with lots and lots of room. A big, big table with lots and lots of food. A big, big yard where we can play football. A big, big house. It's my Father's house. Brings back so many memories, so many memories. Listen, life can be full of ups and downs. Highs and lows. It can feel often like a roller coaster. You know that feeling of exhilaration? Everything is at the highest high, and then all of a sudden, the bottom falls out, and your stomach ends up in your throat. Life can be a journey full of uncertainty and struggles. We face challenges, sometimes on a daily basis, a week-by-week basis, that test our faith, that test our relationships, that test our resolve, and test our hope. There are moments in life when it feels like we've lost our way. There are moments when we feel like we are way in over our heads. There are moments when we can't even see a light at the end of the tunnel. And in these moments, we all have this longing for something more. Is there something more? We long for things like comfort and security, stability, direction, something that we can hold on to, something that Jesus calls a home. A home. Now, the psalmist also articulates this longing that we each have in us. In Psalm 42, the psalmist writes, "As the deer longs for streams of water, so I long for you, O God. I thirst for God, the living God. Where can I go to stand before him?" In Psalm 84, the psalmist articulates this longing by saying, "How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of heaven's armies. I long, yes, I faint with longing to enter the courts of the Lord." We've had this longing in us from the beginning of time. A longing for something more, a longing for something certain and something stable when things are moving. And in the midst of life's uncertainty, the words of Jesus in John 14, verses 1 through 3, offer us such great comfort and hope. So I want to share with you what I see in John 14, what I see Jesus offering you. Whenever life is uncertain, when life is out of whack, when life is full of chaos, when you experience loss, I believe these three verses offer you something for those moments. So number one, Jesus offers us someone that we can trust in every circumstance. The first words Jesus speaks are meant to calm the disciples' troubled hearts. Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." This isn't a command. This is a comfort. This is him comforting his followers and, more importantly, his friends that he cares deeply for. See, Jesus, he understands the human heart. He understands your heart. He knows the anxieties and the fears that we all experience, whether it's the fear of the unknown, the fear of loss, the fear of failure. Jesus doesn't dismiss our emotions or tell us to ignore our worries. Instead, he invites us to trust in something beyond ourselves, something beyond the circumstances. And that something that he invites us to trust in is him. He is the rock that we can stand on when everything else is shifting. Now notice that Jesus does not say, "Hey, don't be troubled because there's nothing to be troubled about." Instead, he offers us the origin of peace. Trust in God and trust also in me. He is the beginning of all things. He is the beginning of the peace that goes beyond understanding. The antidote to a troubled heart is not the absence of troubles. It's the presence of trust, or what we call faith. Faith in God and faith in Jesus. It provides a foundation for the peace that surpasses every situation that we will face. When the world feels like it's falling apart, and it will, Jesus tells us this. The initial invitation from Jesus is not to find a solution, but to trust in the one who holds everything together. Jesus' words here are an invitation to trust in him, to place our confidence not in our own understanding, but in his wisdom, in his power, in his love, and his plan. The second thing that Jesus offers us in John 14 is he offers us hope. Hope that says there is so much more to come. Even when you can't see the light at the end of the tunnel, Jesus says there is more to come. He says there is more than enough room in my Father's home. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place for you? It's Jesus' way of asking us, like, are you going to take me serious? Are you going to trust what I tell you? Because I'm telling you there is more to come. Will you trust me? Jesus, in John 14, verse 2, gives us a glimpse into what awaits us beyond this life. And what awaits us beyond this life is the home that we have all been longing for. A home with him, that is prepared by him and is sustained by him. These words, they're deeply comforting because they speak of something that is eternal, not something that changes overnight. It comes with an eternal belonging and security that every single human being longs for, that every single one of us desires. When Jesus talks about the Father's house, it is a metaphor for what we call heaven, which is God's eternal dwelling place, a place that exists in the here and now, and a place that will exist forever. It's the place where God's presence fills every corner and where his people will live in perfect peace and love and joy forever. When Jesus speaks of this Father's home being full of many rooms, it's a promise of an ever-expanding table. God's table is ever-expanding. There will always be enough room in the Father's house for you. You will never get to a place where, sorry, there's not an empty chair. There will always be an empty chair, an empty seat at his table. No one who belongs to Christ will be excluded. The idea that Jesus is going to prepare a place for us, it speaks to Jesus' intentionality and care for which he is shaping our future. See, heaven is not a vague, impersonal destination. It's a place that Jesus himself is intentionally preparing for us, for those who love him. It's a place that has been designed to meet your deepest needs and desires. It's not just about a physical place, but it's about being in the perfect, eternal presence of God. The final thing that Jesus offers us in John 14 is he offers us a promise that he will come back to restore all things, and he will take us home to be with him. I don't think we talk about this enough. This is our hope, my friends. Our hope is that death will not have the final word. Amen? That the grave will not win. That there is something more. That this world is not the end of the story. That there is something more beyond this place. Jesus assures his disciples in John 14, verse 3, that he will not leave them. He will not leave them or forsake them. He says, when everything is ready, I will come and I will get you so that you will always be where I am. This is the promise that Jesus will return. Just as God came in flesh in the person of Jesus after the people of God did not hear from him for 400 years, just as Jesus came back to life after being crucified and buried, Jesus, God in flesh, the one who right now sits at the right hand of the Father, will come back in order to restore all things and take us home to be with him. This is the promise that Jesus gives us in John 14, verse 3. This is our hope. God gave the Apostle John a chance to see what this will look like in flesh in Revelation chapter 21. John writes these words. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, or behold, or take hold of, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. My friends, that's your hope. You put your hope in anything in this world, and it will disappoint you. It will lead to more mourning, more tears, more pain, more sickness. I can guarantee that. Look at human history. Your hope will be disappointing. So our hope has to be beyond this place. Are we tracking? It has to be beyond us. And our hope is in the new heaven and the new earth. And did you notice that it comes to us? Did you see that? It's not something that we have to work to get to, but it comes to us so that God can dwell with us, which has been God's dream from the very beginning. The return of Christ, the new heaven and the new earth, the moment when God's dwelling place will become our eternal home that we have always longed for. This is not just some future event to be speculated about. It is a promise to hold on to. It's a hope to anchor our hearts and our minds. For those who have trusted in Jesus, who've said yes to Jesus, there is a certain future for you. And that future is eternal. And that future is with Him. This promise, it also points us to the reality that our ultimate home, this is not in this world. We are just pilgrims passing through. This is not ours. Our true citizenship, in the words of Paul in Philippians 3, is in heaven, in Jesus' kingdom. So life may be difficult, but we are called to live with a forward-looking hope, knowing that one day, we will be home. We will be home. Let me do a quick review of these three things that Jesus offers us. I want to give you just a couple minutes to share with those around you which one of these is good news for you today. Number one, Jesus offers us someone that we can trust in every circumstance. Number two, Jesus offers us hope that says that there is so much more to come. And finally, Jesus offers us the promise that He will come back to restore all things and take us home to be with Him. Which one of those is good news to you this morning?